Hey guys, it's Greg with Apple Explained, and today we're going to explore the history of the eMac. This topic was the second place winner of last week's voting poll, and if you didn't get to vote, make sure you're subscribed. That way the voting polls will show up right in your activity feed, and you can let me know which video you'd like to see next. Now, in this video, we're going to cover the eMac, but it's important to note that this product was actually a spin-off of the iMac G3. So in order to fully understand the eMac's place in the market, we're going to cover the iMac as well. So let's begin by turning the clock back to 1998, when the personal computer industry was turned upside down with the introduction of the iMac. You see, personal computers were becoming more and more popular, both in the education setting and for personal home use. People were starting to understand and realize that these fantastic machines could cut production time, make life easier by offering information at the touch of a finger, and open lines of communication they had never experienced, and all for a pretty affordable price. Computers at the time were essentially boxes of technology that weren't expected to serve an aesthetic purpose, but rather a functional purpose. So although they got the job done, they were all pretty ugly and boring to look at. But in 1998, the concept of the personal computer was about to change forever, and it was all thanks to the iMac G3. This machine was a revolutionary product that featured a colorful egg-shaped design that was so unusual that it appeared to be from another planet. This new machine also featured a USB port instead of the serial bus connector that was standard at the time. There was one thing it was missing though, and that was a floppy drive. Instead, it had a CD drive, and other computer manufacturers followed suit, which eventually led to the floppy drive becoming obsolete. So the iMac proved to be an extremely important product for Apple, especially considering it saved them from near bankruptcy. Now, one of the headlining features of the iMac was its ability to quickly connect to the internet right out of the box. In fact, the I in iMac originally stood for Internet, and this may have been one of its most important features since the internet was booming during this time and consumers were looking for an easy way to get online. But the internet wasn't only being used for messaging in chat rooms or playing web-based games, it was the largest, most accessible source of information in the world, and this had a huge appeal to the education market. After all, the internet was first tested by universities after it was invented by the US Department of Defense. So schools naturally took interest in the iMac G3 since the product was built around the internet. Apple recognized this demand from the education market and set out to create a more affordable machine for schools and universities. But there was one problem, because in 2002, Macintosh computers began to switch from CRT to LCD displays. This was an expensive change, and Apple knew they couldn't afford to put an LCD display in a low-cost machine, so it was at this point when Apple launched a lower-end version of the iMac called the eMac, where the E was short for education. So the eMac was an all-in-one desktop computer aimed at the education market and sold exclusively to schools and universities. It was priced at $999, which was much more affordable than the $1,799 entry price of the iMac G4. The eMac's design appeared to be very similar to the iMac G3, but Apple made some changes in order to cut production costs. For example, its shell was no longer translucent like the iMac's. It didn't feature an integrated handle, and it was only sold in white. That way, Apple could save money on manufacturing and price the eMac in reach of the education market. As for the internals, Apple didn't compromise since it featured a PowerPC G4 processor that was quite a bit faster than most G3 chips, and it had a 17-inch flat CRT display. This was a huge improvement over other offerings for educators, and many schools took note. But it wasn't just teachers and professors who expressed interest in the machine, because after being on the market for just 1 month, the popularity and demand for the eMac was just as high among consumers as it was among educators. And Apple quickly opened sales of the eMac to consumers, offering the computer as a less expensive alternative to the second generation LCD iMac G4. Although its price for consumers was $1,099, $100 more than its price for educators. But there was a downside to the eMac, and that was its weight. At 50 pounds or 31.7 kilograms, paired with the absence of a handle, the eMac lacked portability, which could have been an issue for schools who move machines around depending on where they're needed. Now, I should also mention a technical issue that plagued quite a few eMacs during their lifespan, and that problem was called the Raster Shift, where the bottom portion of the computer's display would go black, shifting images up and off the top portion of the display. This was caused by a faulty video cable, and Apple did offer a solution by replacing the affected cable. As with all Apple computers, improvements to the eMac were made over its lifespan. Yearly upgrades in speed, graphics, and memory made the eMac computers even more popular. In 2003, an eMac was released that had a faster ATI Radeon 7500 graphics processor and AirPort Extreme support. In April 2004, the first upgraded eMac appeared on the market. This machine had increased RAM, faster memory, a faster ATA bus, faster optical drives, and a faster graphics chip. It also received a $200 price drop. There were two models available, a low-end model with a 40GB hard drive and a combo drive for $799, or a high-end model with an 80GB hard drive and a super drive for $999. 2005 brought an even faster version of the eMac, which again had increased RAM and a faster dual-layer super drive on the high-end model. There was also a larger hard drive and faster graphics chips on both models, so it was up to the consumer to decide how large of a hard drive and how much RAM they wanted. The low-end model offered an 80GB hard drive and 256MB of RAM and a combo drive for $799, while the high-end model featured a 160GB hard drive, 512MB of RAM, and a super drive for $999. Now, in October 2005, without making any major announcements, Apple withdrew consumer sales of the eMac and sold it exclusively to education customers. There was no explanation as to why Apple decided to pull the machine from the consumer market, although some analysts believed Apple wanted to force customers to purchase the more expensive Mac Mini or iMac, which had higher profit margins. The eMac's lifespan was short-lived, from 2002 to 2006, and was ultimately discontinued in favor of the iMac, which Apple could manufacture more inexpensively than the eMac. So in 2006, the eMac was pulled from the market and replaced by a lower-end iMac, which again, was only sold to the education market. Now, within the past few years, education consumers have integrated the use of Apple's iPad into elementary and middle school classrooms. Up to now, Google and Microsoft have led the education market, despite Apple's long history in the space. But with the iPad, Apple is positioning themselves in a very interesting way. The company continues to lower the iPad's price to make it more accessible in an apparent attempt to conquer the post-PC education market. Although the iPad is an educational frontrunner with its ease of use, accessibility, and app marketplace, they've been severely lacking when it comes to integration with existing educational systems and software. At its recent Apple Education event, the company announced it was going to be releasing some new learning tools for the iPad, including the Apple Pencil, Classroom, an app that assists teachers in managing lessons, Schoolwork, an app where assignments can not only be created but also monitored, and an update to the iWork suite of apps. They've also allowed students 200 gigabytes of iCloud storage space for free, but it's limited to students who have Apple IDs that were provided by their school. Apple also announced a new iPad model during their education event. It weighs just 1.03 pounds or 16.5 ounces and offers support for the Apple Pencil, which previously was only available on the higher-end iPad Pros. And when considering how the iPad compares to other notebooks on the education market, it's easy to see why an iPad could be more appealing. It's lighter and more versatile than a notebook computer, not to mention how the Apple Pencil transforms a student's ability to take and organize notes. Pricing is also a major factor when it comes to education, and Apple realizes that although software and apps are important, the iPad needs to be affordable in order to appeal to students and their parents. And when considering the 2018 iPad's price of $329, it beats out most of its notebook competitors. This means that the iPad has more to offer educators and students at a lower price than its competition. And if you're wondering why Apple doesn't offer a low-cost notebook for the education market, it's because they believe tablets are the future of technology in today's post-PC era. And while computers aren't going away anytime soon, the use of tablets make technology and education more accessible to younger students in elementary school and to students with special needs. In fact, many elementary and middle schools today are requiring students use iPads in their daily studies. And there are definite advantages to this decision, including helping to give students who excel in academics the opportunity to move ahead in the curriculum, and this could prevent students from stagnating and becoming bored because there's no room to grow without actually skipping a grade. The use of technology also allows instructors the opportunity and ability to help students outside of the classroom. Students can be in touch with teachers in real time and get answers to questions without physically being in the classroom. So many believe that the use of technology offers a win-win for both both students and teachers. And the use of iPads not only helps students learn basic technological skills, but also gives them more freedom in learning, prepares them for more advanced technology use in their higher grades, and helps them gain more knowledge for real-world technological experiences. Apple's development of the eMac started a domino effect in education that's still in use today. Children are beginning to access technology much earlier in life, and the opportunity to use this tool for learning purposes should not be ignored. The iMac, eMac, and iPads are and always have been user-friendly and easy for children and adults to understand. The days of writing your papers on actual lined paper are, for the most part, a thing of the past. Where you used to only type final drafts on a computer, today nearly all the work from research to actual writing is being done on tablets or notebooks. In fact, many high school students are required to bring notebooks or tablets into the classroom, and many don't realize that Apple and the eMac opened doors in educational institutions that may have never been opened without Apple's developments in technology. So that is the history of the eMac, and if you want to vote for the next video topic, don't forget to subscribe. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.